Okay, welcome to this third day of the Randomness School. So my name is Krzysztof Pietrzak, I'm from IST Austria. And today I will tell you a bit more about pseudo-entropy, but we will actually start with information theoretic crypto. So what I will try is because so the organizers asked me to talk about specific topics, in particular leakage resilient crypto. So it will be large parts of this of the stuff that I will show you will be actually stuff that I've been involved in. And I will, you know, use this opportunity to not only show you the technical results one by one, but also give you kind of a story how we actually sometimes more accidentally than not arrived at these results and what worked and what didn't. So the first roughly hour or so I will talk about information theoretic crypto, more concretely about intrusion-resilient cryptography, and even more concretely about intrusion-resilient secret sharing. Even though the primitive itself didn't turn out to be particularly useful or people don't use it, but a tool that we developed in this within this process, which is called alternating extraction, turned out to be very useful for many other applications, in particular for leakage-resilient cryptography, which I will then mention in the like middle part of my talk. And then at the, you know, maybe for the last hour or so, I will come back to pseudo-entropy, so I will kind of catch up where Leo left yesterday, and I will show you, for example, the so also what Leo mentioned yesterday, a counterexample to the conditional chain rule for Hill entropy. And also, maybe even the story how we went there was more interesting than the actual result. So I got like this new toy here, an iPad, so I will try to partially do the talk on this thing, and if it doesn't work, I might switch back to the blackboard, to the whiteboard, and maybe also definitions and things like that I might do on the whiteboard so they stay. Okay, and if you have any questions at any time point, just interrupt me. I think we are not such a big group, so we can make it more or less interactive. Okay, so let's see, so let's need this. Intrusion secret. Okay, so who has heard about secret sharing? So I think most of you, yeah, exactly, everybody who has taken the basic course knows secret sharing. It was introduced in 73, independently by Sharman and Blakely. And for the sake of this talk, I will actually look at the simplest form of secret sharing, namely of n out of n secret sharing. So I want to share a secret amongst n parties such that, you know, when they all come together, they can reconstruct it. But any n minus one of them have like information theoretically no idea about what the shared secret is. In fact, I will, for the sake of this talk, even just look at two out of two secret sharing, so just two parties. And to make things even simpler, I will look at something that is called random secret sharing. So the secret that those parties actually share will be like a random string. But it's easy to turn a random secret sharing into a general secret sharing by then using this random string as a one-time path to encrypt the message. So if you want to share a random string amongst two parties, so you have a dealer. Can you read this? Yeah. So if a dealer, we have two players, P1, P2. And the dealer wants to, you know, send out the secrets. And of course, the simplest way to do this is, you know, let's just give them uniformly random string R1, R2. Both. It's kind of weird to write on this iPad because I have to look down. Both say L bit strings, right? And the shared secret will be simply R1. Bitwise XOR R2. And if we now want to share a secret message amongst them, we can also publicly announce or give to one of the players, let's call this a key K. We can also simply announce a ciphertext C, which is the message XORed with the key. And, you know, this C can either be public or given to one of the players. And I claim this is a secret sharing. Why? Because, of course, if both of them come together, they have R1, R2, they compute the key K, they kind of decrypt this one-time path secret ciphertext C, and they get the message M. On the other hand, if you just get one, any one of the players independently has no information about the key K and thus about the message M. So this is something that you probably learned in an introductory crypto course. This is something that Shannon already showed, right? So if you have, let's say you have R1, so what we want to what one has to show information is that M1 is kind of uniformly distributed or have no information about the the message M given what? Given the secret, the ciphertext C, and, you know, either R1 or R2 symmetric. So we're not going to do this this math here, but that's a very simple two out of two secret sharing. So, okay, that's well and fine. So now I want to introduce another concept, which is called intrusion resilience. So if you have the secret sharing, you know, we have these two parties that hold the secret, But maybe, you know, they hold this secret on their laptops or on their iPhones. And every now and then, a virus comes along, the device gets infected, and the secret gets stolen. And to kind of mitigate the consequences of such attacks, the concept of intrusion resilience was introduced, or intrusion resilient cryptography. Intrusion resilient crypto. So who has heard about intrusion resilient cryptography? The general idea, okay, almost nothing, so let me say a few words about this. So this has been introduced independently by Jambowski in 06, at TCC 06, and then DiCrescenzo, Lipton, Wolfish at TCC 1 year later. The idea is very simple. So if you have your device, let's see, this is your computer, it has like some short secret, maybe a secret key or a share, like in secret sharing or some other thing that you really perish. And now, then this virus, for example, can just take your secret key, you know, this 1024 bits or whatever, and send it out to the adversary. That's what happens all the time. The idea of intrusion resilient secret sharing is to simply, you know, maybe we can, it's very hard to prevent computers to get infected every now and then, but the idea is that the bandwidth that so even if your computer gets infected and you have a virus on it, maybe the amount of information that the virus can send out from your computer is bounded. Maybe once it's sent out, you know, sending out hundreds of gigabytes, you will kind of realize this, or you kind of like other mechanisms that kind of detect this kind of infection and take some countermeasures. So the idea is simply to, you know, have again your device, but the key now is huge. Think 100 gigs or something like that. And the security notion that one wants for intrusion resilient schemes is the following. Even if an adversary, so even if you get the virus on your computer, and the virus manages to send out not the entire key, but say some function phi of k, which is say 50 gigabytes or something. So it's an arbitrary function of your secret key. And you know, the virus on the computer can process this 100 gigabytes as he wants. He has to compress it to 50 gigs and sends out this compressed key. And what we want is basically security, whatever this secret is useful. What we want is that the scheme still remains secure, assuming that the key K has still sufficiently high mean entropy, right? So we want security while, let's say, the mean entropy of the key K, given the view of the adversary, so the adversary has like this compressed key phi of k, is sufficiently large. Yeah. Okay, sorry. So how can we use this, you know, intrusion resilient paradigm for secret sharing? So here's a very simple idea. So again, we have a dealer, let's call him D. And he now, instead of having short secrets R1, R2, let's pick, you know, gigantic secrets, R1, R2. So let's use capital, play a P1, P2. Let's pick capital letters, R1, R2. Think of R1, R2 as 100 gigabyte strings, uniformly random gigabyte strings. What would be the shared secret? So there is something like a two-source. So this is just kind of as a warm-up, so I will not really define the objects we will need. There is something that is called a two-source extractor. So we have seen strong extractors where you had the source, which whenever it had sufficiently high min entropy and you had the uniformly random seed independent of this source, the output was uniformly random given the seed. A two-source extractor is something more, is something even more sophisticated. It takes now two random variables. They have to be independent, but none of them has to be uniformly random. Let's say you have a two-source extractor, takes two variables, and whenever each of them has some minimal amount of min entropy, the output will be uniformly random. So if you have such a two-source extractor, we can define the secret k to be simply the extracted value of R1, R2. And why is this a good intrusion resilient scheme? Yeah, simply because if an adversary now, you know, say he infects the computer of P1, he can leak 50 gigabytes, he computes, then he maybe infects the computer of player P2, he maybe also leaks 50 gigabytes, or maybe even the player P2 infected the computer of P1, so he gets like 50 gigs of of his, that doesn't quite work. Okay, let's say this is intrusion resilient as long as, let's see. Yeah. But this has several, so these are several issues. So I will mention the second issue later. The first issue is, of course, it's highly inefficient for reconstruction, right? So even though these secrets are one or two are huge, 100 gigabytes, and to reconstruct this short secret, really player P1 and P2 have to come together. One of them has to bring their 100 gigabyte shares together and reconstruct the secret. So the communication complexity between them will be huge to reconstruct these things. And there is another issue that I will mention in a second. But let's first address this first issue. Let's just address this first issue, that the communication complexity is huge, right? So this secret sharing is secure. So what I want to say, think of an adversary who kind of leaked. So he infected the computer of P1. He got like some P1 of R1. He infected maybe the computer of the second player. He got P2 of R2. And what one can show is that the key K is still, closed uniformly distributed, or epsilon close if this R1, R2 have sufficiently min entropy, and this is a two-source extractor which outputs epsilon to close uniform keys. So the key K will be still close to uniform even given this 50 gigs leakage of this both shares. Okay, let's first fix the first issue. How can we make the communication complexity for reconstructing the secret? Because the key K will usually be very short. We only want the shares to be huge to have this intrusion resilient problem. So a simple trick to make the reconstruction efficient is the following. Let's say player P1 not only has this huge share R1, but let's also give him a short seat S1, and let's give the player P2 also a short seat S2. And now, to reconstruct the secret, let's use a regular extractor. Let's say the key K is defined as we extract from R1 a short, maybe 1,000-bit secret or so, but using the seed S2, so the seed from the other guy, S2, and maybe XOR this with. And then symmetrically, we extract from S2 using the seed S1. Now, as before, this key K will actually still stay close to uniformly random, even if you have leakage from both, from both sides, as long as this leakage is not too big. But on the other hand, now the reconstruction of the secret is very efficient, because player P1 and P2 can reconstruct the secret by simply having the player P1 sending P2 over his short seed S1. The player P2 will compute, let's call this here K1. The player P2 will compute this short key K1. Sorry, K1, this is the one. Send it over to player P1. And he will also send his seed S2. Player P1 will compute the key, which he now can do because he has the seed S2. He has the key K1, so he can compute the key K. And, we have reconstructed the secret with very short communication. Okay, so we're almost there. This is already kind of, we have like an intrusion resilient secret sharing scheme. Both players have huge secret, even if you leak 50 gigs from any site. Yes? No, they can leak. So I come to that now.
Why do you have to use a two-source extractor?
Here you don't have to use a two-source. So the lower thing, the upper thing is a two-source extractor because.
Why can't you?
Because there is no seed, no short uniform seed, no? I just have like this two huge R1, R2s.
Can you not give them to the player?
I did, right? That was the second solution. Then in the second step, I said, let's give them short seeds, define the key as in orange down here. And this has now the advantage that they can also reconstruct much more efficiently because they just have to exchange these short seeds. Okay, so there is like one big problem here, or big problem, maybe issue. I told you that this is intrusion resilient scheme, even if not, so this key K will stay uniform, even if the adversary gets, leakage phi1 of R1, phi2 of R2. But this is still true for this new scheme down there, but this is only true if this leakage function phi1, phi2 is independent of, let's say, if the leakage function phi2, for example, is independent of the leakage function from phi1. So here is like, if you're not forced to choose this phi1, phi2 independently, but you can, you know, maybe first choose phi1, then choose phi2, and maybe then attack the other one, the other, let's see if we can do this on this thing, attack the other guy again. Here is an attack, so maybe that's, let's see, so we have player 1 has R1, S1, player 2 has R2, S2. So what an adversary could do is, you know, he has his virus, he infects the machine of this computer here, and he leaks something very short. He just leaks this very short S1, right? So this is defined as the leakage of, he defines his leakage function phi, no, he can define this leakage function phi1 to leak just the secret S1. Now, once he knows S1, he infects the computer of this second guy, and he defines his leakage function phi2 to depend on the leakage he learned from the first share, right? So he defines this simply as, you know, infect that computer, extract from SR2 something, and give me that back. Sorry. This is so, so this is the leakage. So infect the computer, give me back the short seed S2, but also give me back, you know, use the seed S1 to extract something from S2. And let's, maybe he goes back to the player P1 and infects him again. Now he knows S2, so he can learn the short value extracted from R1 using the seed S2. And at this point, he has reconstructed the entire secret, right? Everyone with me so far? Okay. So I'm.
So my question is, so you kind of assume that both parties are honest themselves?
I mean, these are just shares lying around on some servers, you know, they just, yeah, exactly. So now, even for secret sharing, I actually would even want to have security, even if you have this thing in the full or against this player. But now I even look at the player from the outside who has actually none of the shares. He just kind of infects this computer, gets S1, infects this one, gets the key K2 and S2, infects this one again, gets the first key K1. And of course, if this is like a malicious guy, he can even do, you know, he infects this guy once, gets back K2, and he's done. He can extract. Okay. But you already see there is a little bit more going on than before. What we have to do here is that, you know, the adversary has to infect this guy, then go over to this guy, and then go back to the first guy. So at least he has to kind of alternate already a little bit. And, you know, let's push this even further. And this was actually how alternating extraction came up. We said, can we have such a scheme, you know, which is intrusion resilient? But in order, you know, okay, we want an efficient reconstruction procedure. So we want that the player P1 and P2 exchanging T short messages will be able to reconstruct the secret. This means that no matter what we do, if we consider an adversary who can kind of infect the first player, output something, then infect the second player, output something short, infect the first player again, if he can do this T times, he will always be able to kind of reconstruct the secret. But let's make T big, 100. What if the adversary is only allowed to infect, you know, the players alternatingly 99 times? But now we allow the adversary to actually not just kind of output like short leakage, like the original construction procedure, but a lot. Maybe even, you know, 50 gig on average of the entire messages. Can you get the scheme that is still secure in this setting? And this is exactly what alternating extraction is about. Or intrusion resilient secret sharing is about. And it's achieved using a concept that is called alternating extraction. And this alternating extraction works roughly as follows. It works as follows. So now, let me not call them player P1 and P2, but just to be consistent with actually how these players are called in the literature. One player is called Quentin, and he has like a huge secret Q, and some, you know, some short seed S1. And then we have another player W. I think W starts for Wendelin or something. Somebody knows the name? Wendelin or Wendelin? Okay, Quentin and Wendelin. Wendy, I think, Wendy. So Quentin and Wendy. So each, you know, each of them has this huge 100 gigabyte share. And now I simply define a protocol between them, these two players, and then I will later tell you what property this protocol has. In fact, I already mentioned it before. So this protocol will have T rounds for whatever, you know, T, fix some T, 100, and it works as follows. In the first round, Quentin simply sends over S1 to Wendy. Wendy takes S1 and computes the value R1. How? She uses some normal standard strong extractor, and she extracts some value R1 from her big secret W using the seed S1 she just got from Quentin. Quentin gets, you know, this R1, and you can guess what he does. He computes a value S2 by extracting some, you know, again, short seed S2 from his big random variable Q using the seed R1 he just got from Wendy, and so on. You know, this goes on up to, you know, ST. Let me just draw a few more lines because we will use it. R2, S3, SR4, I think that's going to be enough. Okay. Okay. So now I want to prove a theorem about this very simple protocol. And for this, I will need a little bit of notation. I mean, just notation is a strong word. Just let me define some variables. So here's the first observation. Of course, Quentin and Wendy can reconstruct, can compute ST for any T of our choice, exchanging 2 times T minus 1 messages. And here I mean short messages. In fact, using a good extractor, the messages can be as short as something like logarithmically in the length of Q and W, log n plus logarithmic in 1 over epsilon, where epsilon will be the distance from uniform that our extractors provides you. So they can compute this, you know, this string ST using just 2T minus 1, very short messages. And you know, another short remark, is this efficient? No, at the end of the day, we want, you know, we want to use this protocol in some schemes. You say this extractor gets W as input. W is huge, right? 100 gigs. So you say, okay, maybe the communication complexity is small, but the computation is huge because every time the extractor has to read the entire W. But there is something actually invented by Salil, who we'll talk tomorrow, that is called a locally computable extractor. And this is basically an extractor that has the following nice guarantee. If you have a gigantic string, 100 gigs, it's guaranteed to have some min entropy, maybe 10%, like 10 gigs. Then this extractor will only, and this extractor gets like a uniform random seed, and you want to kind of compute output something that is close to uniform, but fairly short compared to the min entropy in the big seed. So maybe I just want 1,000 bits and not like 10 gigs in the big thing. And this extractor will have the very nice property that it only needs to read a tiny fraction of the actual big W, which tiny fraction will be actually specified also by this seed. So basically, think of this huge thing. The extractor will basically first read a few chunks and then actually extract from these few chunks. So it will be even, not only the communication complexity is very low here, even the computation complexity is basically logarithmic in the length of these variables. Okay. So now, of course, you know, they can compute ST using 2T minus 1 messages. And what I want to show you is, what I want to prove you now is that they will not be able to compute ST using even one message less, even if they can communicate much, much more than what we have here. So assume that now they kind of divert from the protocol because they want to compute ST using one message less. And with the first message, S1, Q not only sends S1, but also some reasonably, potentially rather long string M1Q. So this is for the notation. M1Q means the first message Q sends. And then W will not just send back R1, but also some message M1W, M2Q, and so on. So this is just to set notation, and so on. So everyone with me? So now we look at kind of, if you want, cheating parties, which will later capture the fact that you will look at adversary who corrupt Quentin and can leak a large string M1Q. Then they corrupt Wendy and they can leak a large string M1W and go back and forth. And you will show that unless they go back and if they only can go back and forth 2T minus 1 times, the secret ST will be close to uniform. Okay, a bit more notation. Let's call, if we have all these messages here, let's call them M1 what representation MR2, for example. So M and subject R2, RI or SI will be all the messages up to and including the message in the subscript. And now a last notation thing. Up to R2. Let's call this here the view of Quentin after he sent, after he received the second message. So V stands for view, Q is the superscript, Quentin of Wendy's view, and the subscript will be after seeing, after receiving the ith message. So in particular, let's pick another nice color. This will be the view of Wendy 2. So this is just to set some notation. And now I come to the theorem, and maybe I do the theorem on the blackboard so we can have the protocol and the theorem on the... So what is the theorem I want to prove? So as I said before, the theorem I want to prove is that no matter what Quentin and Wendy do, they will not be able to compute ST, exchanging even one message less than is necessary to trivially reconstruct it with very low communication complexity. I have to make some assumption about the amount of messages that they exchange, because if Quentin just sends her entire queue over to Wendy, you know, Wendy can just locally compute whatever she wants, any SI. So for the theorem, we will first assume, can everyone read that? Okay, theorem. That's not very good. So this is the alternating extraction theorem. So assume that the messages exchanged between Wendy and Quentin are not too long. Concretely, if I assume that the extractor that we use is an epsilon k average case extractor, which means that whenever the source has at least k bits of min entropy, or even average case conditional min entropy that Leo presented yesterday, the output will be epsilon close to uniform. So assume that all the messages up to message I sent from Quentin to Wendy have total length, at most the length of q, minus k, so k is what we need to still extract. And let's be even more general. Maybe q is not uniform to start with, but just has some min entropy q. If q is uniform, then this is just the length of q. So as long as the messages are just k bits, totally k bits shorter than the min entropy that was originally presented in q. And moreover, the messages it sent in the other direction have the same. The messages sent from Wendy to Quentin are also, you know, as long or contain as decrease the min entropy of W almost entirely, just leave at least k bits. Then the following is true. Then I claim that. Okay, now let me do it. What I claim is, for concreteness, let's pick I to be 2. I claim that, you know, as long as these messages that Wendy received, so this 1 plus S2, as long as this leaves enough min entropy in Q, then S3, for example, given the view of Wendy up to this point, so, you know, all this, everything up here, so everything she received so far in the secret, this S3 will be almost uniform given the entire view of Wendy. How close to uniform? Let's see, so to get you some intuition, how close is S1 to uniform given Wendy's view? I mean, it's picked uniformly at random, independent of W, so S1 is going to be perfectly uniform as it arrives. Then R1 from Quentin's view, R1, this is epsilon, you know, R1 is going to be epsilon close to uniform because W has high entropy, so S1 is. So from Quentin's view, R1 is going to be like roughly epsilon close to uniform. Okay, then S2 is kind of extracted from Q, but not with the uniform random seed, but the seed that is kind of epsilon far from uniform. So actually, this S2 will be 2 epsilon away from uniform. and this Arth, and so on. So Si plus 1, so the next S to be received by Wendy, given her view up to this point, will be 2 epsilon I close to uniform . So to define this notation, if I have two variables, left and right, so then this tilde with the subscript means, the subscript here means that these two variables are, you know, whatever the subscript is close to uniform. This is statistical distance, as we've seen yesterday. So this simply means that the distribution of Si plus 1 and the view of Wendy and the uniformly random string, independent of everything, of the same length at S, and the view of Wendy at time I, after receiving the ith message, those two strings will be 2 epsilon plus I close to uniform. Yes? The output, yeah, there will be some output. The output will be epsilon close to uniform as long as there is k bits min entropy. So the output has to be less than k, obviously. So the output will be, if it's a standard extractor, the output will be actually, if we use the best leftover hash, the output can be at most k minus 2 log 1 over epsilon, and we can come close to that even for extractors with very short seeds.
So think about extreme, trivial cases, identity function, Q and W are uniform. It seems the signal can be revealed. Q, think about the identity functions.
What is the identity? Not the identity function is not an extractor.
Yeah, I know. For the uniform.
Okay. Initially, but you know, once we start exchanging messages, they're not uniform anymore given the view, right? So this is the average case extractor, which says as long as the variable we look at has k bits of average case min entropy conditioned on whatever has been seen so far. So this is this type of extractors. This M is, okay, so you know, they are arbitrary. This is anything that can be computed from whatever has been seen so far. And I will assume that S1 is always part of the MIs, actually, say, because I didn't actually write this here. So I assume that they are very short, so this is neither necessary, but it's also not much loss of generality. So just for the proof, it gets a little bit easier to assume that the SIs are always part of it. And then there is the symmetric statement for the RIs. You know, this is from Wendy's view, how close to uniform these I's are, and also the RIs will be uniform from Quentin's view. Okay. So that's the theorem. So how do we prove that? Okay. I don't want the proof here because then it's. But then I also want to leave this on the screen. So let's make the proof at the board over there. Proof. I will prove this basically by induction. So I will assume that Si plus 1 is delta, for some delta, delta close to uniform, given, so again, notation-wise, if I write something like this, so this is, for example, let's call this C, B, C. Sometimes I will, if I have tuples like this, I will shortcut this, abbreviate this, and simply say, now this is the tuple AC is epsilon close to the tuple BC, or this, if this the second part is identical, then I'll simply write A is epsilon close to B, conditioned on C. That's just the notational convention here. So this basically says the same as we had over the board, on the board over there, with delta being 2 epsilon I. So what I will show is a proof by induction. So I will assume for some I that indeed this I is close to uniform, and show that this implies that also the next Ri will be close to uniform. And what does close mean here? Close means delta plus epsilon. So you have the extra epsilon here. RI. Oh, it's uniform. Right, so if you look at the picture there, this basically says if given the view of Wendy up to, say, this point here, this S3 is delta close to uniform, then I will conclude from that that this R3 will be delta plus epsilon close to uniform given the view of Quentin. So it's not totally trivial because this, you know, this closeness is conditioned on this entire part on the right, whereas this is on the entire part on the left. But we will get there. And again, I will prove a symmetric statement for the RIs. So if for some delta prime, the RI is close to uniform given Quentin's view, then and I claim that once I prove this, we're done. Why are we done? Because once we proved these implications, we know that S1 is actually zero close, or is exactly, you know, identically distributed to the uniform distribution. Because, you know, at initially, S1, QW are, let's assume, sampled definitely independently, but S1 is also sampled uniformly at random, so S1 is going to be uniform. And then if you combine these two steps, then you will see that, okay, this implies that S3 will be 2 epsilon close to uniform because S1, no, you see this is just by induction, you kind of. Okay, so let's focus on this proving this thing. And even kind of less important than really following the proof step by step is that you get the right intuition for these kind of things. Because with information theoretic proofs, it's really more often than not, it's the case that you really have the right intuition. And once you have the intuition, the rest is really just careful and pedantic math. OK. So where do I have the proof, actually? 3, 4, I. Okay. So first, I don't like this, you know, I have this view of W here and here the view of Quentin. I kind of don't like that. So instead of conditioning on this entire, so, you know, this S3 is uniformly random conditioned on the entire view, I will only say that I will kind of assume something weaker. I will only assume that it's kind of close to uniform conditioned on the messages exchanged so far, which of course are part of the entire view as before, but I would just kind of, in the first step, I claim that this here, this is equivalent to say, or implies that Si plus 1 is delta close to uniform. Now, given just the messages exchanged up to this point, which with the notation we had would be MRI. Later, we will actually go back and say from the messages, expand to the entire state, and this will be kind of a more careful, you know, there we need to be more careful with arguing. But here, if some variable is epsilon close to uniform conditioned on something, if I just ignore something of the conditional part, it's not going to get, you know, I'm not going to learn more. It's not going to increase the statistical distance. Okay. So now what I want to prove is, as we state this, so I have this Si plus 1. There is some variable W. Sorry. So first, so that's what I assume. S1 is delta close to uniform conditioned on the messages so far. Now I add something here, which will be just a function of Si and something independent of Si. So that I have to show you. So I claim that it's still true. So I add something here, namely here I take this W, I extract from W. And I claim this is still. So why is this true? Why can't I kind of just, I had these two variables which are delta close condition on something. And now I claim they're still delta close if I add something. So if this would be just a function of Si plus 1, this is like a standard, standard fact from information theory. You cannot increase statistical distance by computation. So if you have A and B are delta closed, then F of A and F of B for any function F, randomized or deterministic, still will be delta close or closer. Because, but there is this W here, right? But I claim that this W is independent of Si conditioned on the view. So more concretely, I claim that Si plus 1, the messages exchanged up to that point, and W form a Markov chain. So what does Markov chain mean? Markov chain means that these variables can be all dependent on each other. But the dependence of W and this I plus 1 is totally captured by these intermediate values here. So once I give you MR plus 1, you really don't care, and you want to learn something about W, you really don't care about anymore about this SI plus 1. And why is this the fact? So again, I will not prove it, but look. Here is W. Here is this, say, my SI plus 1. And these are the messages. So initially, this, Actually, let's prove a strong statement first. I claim that Q, this Q, the message is here, and W, that this forms a Markov chain. Then this will also form a Markov chain because this S3 is simply a function of Q and the MIs. Why is this the case? So this is also a lemma that probably is common knowledge, but that we proved in the paper. It says the following. If you have two variables, A and B, they're initially independent. And then you somehow start, you compute something on A, some value on A. Then you compute something on B that can also depend on the messages exchanged so far. And so on. So you have all these messages going back and forth. Then the statement simply says that this A messages B, that this is a Markov chain. And the intuition is kind of clear, because A and B are initially independent. Of course, these messages here depend on both A and B, but kind of the dependence between them is totally captured by this intermediate exchange. So I'm not going to, I probably even couldn't do it on top of my head like the proof, but I hope that you believe me this, right? So you have these two things, initially independent. I start communicating, and then conditioned on this thing in the middle, if you see this, they are still, they form a Markov chain. There is nothing you can learn about W given these messages here, given Q and these messages here, that you cannot already learn about W just given these messages here. Because everything. Another way to see it is that if I give you these messages here and W here, you can actually sample this cube with the right distribution, just seeing the messages here, but ignoring W completely. Because why would you care about W? Just kind of. Okay, so hand wavy, but facts about information. So this is why this first step here is kosher. Okay, but now what is this? This is simply Ri plus 1, right? Okay. So now, let's see. What is this? So this W has high min entropy because we assumed that these messages here leave enough min entropy in W for the extractor to work. So this is uniformly random seed. So this here, actually, is going to be epsilon close to, by definition of the extractor and the fact that W has high min entropy from u prime, for some uniformly random u prime. Now I kind of want to go back and replace this first u with the Si plus 1. I know that it's, delta close. Okay, everything is conditioned on this thing. This is here and this is here. So I have Si plus 1 here, Si plus 1 here. So let's, let's move it to the conditional part. So what I proved to you is that Ri plus 1, which is this here, is there is a triangle inequality for statistical distance. So if A is delta far from B, B is delta far from C, C is epsilon far from E, then A from E is, the sum of all these distances. So this is the triangle inequality that is true for statistical distance. So I add up delta, epsilon, delta to delta plus epsilon Ri plus 1 to this u prime. to uniform, conditioned on what? On Ri1, Si plus 1, which equivalently is just all the messages exchanged up to point Si plus 1. And I'm almost there. There are two problems. First of all, instead of Mi plus 1, I would like to condition on the view of Q. But now I claim that R is the same argument as before. I claim that given the messages, so this R3, given the messages exchanged so far, R is independent of Q. So actually, if I condition just on the messages or on the messages and Q, it's not going to change anything. And this thing here is exactly what I want. That's the view. That's one thing. So this fact that we have like this fact that we have this Markov chains between different sets of variables is used extensively in these proofs. And the other fact that is wrong is this 2 here. Actually, I don't want the 2. And you can prove it directly without the 2. And the original papers were actually wrong. It was actually, we just claimed it without proving it, that it's a delta. You have to really actually write out the probabilities and sum it up directly. Because here we go from Si, we replace it with U, we use the extractor property, and we go back to S. That's why we kind of lose this delta twice, because this S is delta for her. But you can just write out the probabilities, do the math, and kind of you save one delta. OK. Maybe if there's time later, I can show it to you because I have the proof on the iPad. It's like half a page of you know, writing out the things. But I don't want to show it because there's no intuition in that. At least it's kind of clear that you don't have to lose delta twice. But the proof is not giving you more intuition than that. OK. The S. What?
Is it true that the AB is epsilon close to CD, then B is epsilon close to D?
Again?
Just ignore the S.
So what you want to prove is the following. You want to prove, assume that S is delta close to uniform. That you have like an epsilon k extractor. And what you want to show is that then S extract, okay, W has sufficient min entropy. You want to prove that this is delta plus epsilon close to what? To S, comma, oh, sorry, uniform. Right. What I showed you is an extra 2 here. Because I first replaced the S with uniform. Then I replaced this with using delta. I replaced this with uniform using epsilon. I replaced this S back. But you can do it directly. And then, OK. Actually, let me show you. Let me show you the proof. It's on the, if I find it, it should be. OK, so that's the wrong proof, right? So that's what you want to prove. That's what I just showed you. You have an extractor. W has sufficient min entropy. S is delta close to uniform. So if this S was uniform, this would be epsilon close to uniform, but it's not. It's delta far away. And I would like to make a statement about this distribution here, S, U prime. So this pedestrian way to do it, as I showed you there, is, OK, replace S with uniform. That costs you delta. Then once this seat is uniform, we know that this is also epsilon close to uniform by the definition of the extractor. OK, replace S back, and we kind of get what we want. We have to add delta epsilon delta. We get 2 delta plus epsilon. Not good. Right, so how can we avoid this delta? So here is the proof. Without losing it, you just write stuff out. So let me define this delta x to be the distribution, statistical distance of the extracted variable using the particular seed x from uniform. This is just, so that's what we want to bound, right? So the statistical distance of this from this. So first of all, the first argument here, s is the same in both distributions. So it's statistical distance, I can simply sum over the first I kind of write this out, and I write this statistical distance as a sum of statistical distances summing over this first parameter, right? So I sum over all possibilities for x, and then I take the statistical distance of the second argument here. So if you write stuff out, statistical distance, you will see that this is kosher. That's totally nice. Okay, then I do something weird. This is equivalent to, I simply subtract here the probability of, you know, uniform distribution being x, right? And I add it back. So I subtract this term here, and I add it back. So that's exactly the same things. But now let's look at these two terms. What is this? The sum over the probability that the uniform distribution is x, and the statistical distance of the extracted value given x. So this actually, by definition, is the statistical distance of the extracted value from uniform when using a uniform seed. So this is going to be at most epsilon. Okay, what about the right term? So here I make some stupid things. I want to upper bound this. So first of all, I have this minus this. Let's put absolute values left and right. This can only increase stuff, right? Because this could be positive or negative and cancel out. Let's make it, absolute values. Once I have absolute values here, so this delta x is at most 1. So let's be generous. Let's always put it to be 1. So we're left with this. So what is this? By definition, this is just the statistical distance of S and U. So this is delta. So you see this is true, and you gained no intuition, but that's how, That's how you prove it if you have to. And so I have to say that this is actually from the first correct proof of this was actually in the lecture notes of Leo when he was teaching this. And I think the original papers, actually not just ours, also follow-up papers, just stated this, because this fact is so obvious that you kind of just basically, this fact is so obvious that you just state it without proof. And fortunately, in this case, the intuition was correct and everything. Because the two really ruins the theorem. So it looks harmless, but it's an inductive argument. So if you double every time, that's problematic, because you get, instead of, I times 2, you wouldn't get the 2 epsilon I, but 2 to the I times epsilon. It would only be interesting for very small i's. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about the first part. This was alternating extraction. So this went actually much faster than I expected. So do you have any questions about that before we go to the application of alternating extraction, which will be leakage resilient cryptography? No? Okay, so let's go to leakage resilient crypto. And again, so again, what happened, so we proved this in 2007, and it ended up to actually, nobody cares about intrusion resilient secret sharing, but actually several other applications like leakage resilient crypto or key reconciliation, or now also non-malleable extractors and other things use this kind of technique and trick, and are much more interesting than the original application it was devised for. Okay. So what is leakage resilient cryptography? Actually, I can actually start drawing again on my funny. So you prefer whiteboards or this? Why not? Okay, leakage resilient crypto. This is good to see, right? So who has heard about side channel attacks? Okay, good. Most, or I'll be fast. So you know that if you have crypto 101, you learn about you learn that the pillar of modern security is provable security, pioneered by Shafi and Mikali, who just got the Turing Award for that. What we typically do is we kind of anticipate an adversary. So here is an adversary, very angry, and this adversary can attack some kind of crypto system, which we typically model as a black box. So there is some box here. This box has some specified input-output behavior. Typically, it would have some kind of secret inside that we initially sample before the experiment starts. Then the adversary can talk to the box. Let's say it's a signature scheme. So the adversary can say, look, here is a message M. And then the box would say, nice, so here is a signature for M. Right, so there is a secret key K. This is maybe secret key, just for concreteness, right? Maybe the adversary initially even gets the public key. So we sample a public secret key for a signature, the adversary gets a public key, he can query for messages of his choice. At the end of the day, he has to output some message M star, sigma star. And if this is a valid signature on M star and he has not asked for a signature of M star explicitly before, we say he won the game. This is called, and if we can prove that no adversary exists under some assumption that can win this game with non-negligible advantage, we say that the signature scheme is secure under existential forgery under chosen message attack. So that's the kind of stuff that you see in typical crypto lectures. But in practice, this black box doesn't exist, right? It has to typically, if an adversary in the real world interacts with the crypto device, it's a smart card, the ATM machine, maybe a laptop. And potentially this machine leaks much more information than just, than just this black box input-output behavior that we see. For example, it has been demonstrated, I think, mid-90s by Paul Kotcher. He took the smart cards who computed RSA signatures like that, and what he measured on extra information, he just had like a very good stopwatch. He just kind of measured roughly how much time it takes to sign a message. Totally harmless, right? Why would that hurt? But he showed that if you just like straight naively implement RSA signatures, on some device, and then you can kind of measure the running time of this device on different messages, you can actually totally break the scheme. Because RSA computation is multiplications and multiplications and exponentiations, and depending on how the message kind of overlaps with the secret key, with things like that, you have more exponentiations, and then you kind of collect this data, and at some point you solve some system of equations, and you just have the secret key out there. Like running time, right? So very funny. So nowadays there is tons of other side channel attacks have been discovered. The most serious ones are probably power analysis. So people take smart cards and they measure the power that is, the power consumption between the battery or the power source and the chip, and they see how much energy the chip sucks. And from this curve, they kind of can get information about the secret key and so on. So now, so this is a big topic, like the chess community. So this is one of the 7 IACR conferences. Is half of the papers there are about side channel attacks, about coming up with new side channel attacks, about devising countermeasures against these things. And these countermeasures are usually quite ad hoc. So okay, for timing, it's kind of easy to protect. You just make sure that the running time of your algorithm is independent of any kind of secret values. For other things, it gets more complicated. So for power analysis, you can put transistors between the battery and the chip to flatten this out, or you randomize the computation. You do all these ad hoc things. And for us as cryptographers, this is horrible, right? Because we come and we have this beautiful, provably secure schemes. And then what happens in practice, people throw all these heuristics on these things to kind of protect them against what's actually happening. So, it's unsatisfying. So leakage within crypto, the general theme is, can we use provable security, which has been so, tremendously successful in, devising secure cryptographic schemes by, proving schemes via reductions to hard problems and so on, to also say something about side channel attacks. Now, we don't want to go into the chess literature and see what kind of side channel attacks are there, how to protect against them. So we're kind of more ambitious and we say, we want schemes that are secure against, any kind of leakage. We don't know what kind of side channel leakage there is, what information leaks, or just everything, right? So how would we even, almost everything. So how would we even model this? How would you model, just before we want to construct or prove anything, how would you model an adversary who can get arbitrary leakage from a device? We say, look, we now anticipate adversaries who not only can ask some messages like M here, but also choose any leakage function F, just any efficiently computable function. And then they not only get the signature here, but they will get the function F evaluated on the secret key. So maybe this is probabilistic, so it has some random coins, and whatever other secrets have been touched or during the computation there. Of course, in this setting, no security is possible because F could just be the identity function, it just leaks everything. On the other hand, we don't want to make assumptions about what F is, because in provable security, we don't assume that the adversary runs this and this and this attack, and we prove, you know, if he does this, it's not going to work. If he does this, it's not going to work. The only thing we assume is that his running time is bounded, his polynomial time. So here we want to do the same. We don't want to make assumptions about what f is because we don't know. But let's make some assumption. Let's make assume it's bounded. So what does that mean? It's kind of a channel, right? It's a side channel attack. So let's assume the capacity of the channel is bounded, or equivalently that, you know, the length of the output of this leakage function is not too high. Say, with every signature, he gets at most 100 bits of you know, side channel information. Okay. You see, even this is not, in this generality, even this is not possible, because if I just leak the first 100 bits of the secret key in the first step, the second 100 bits in the second, and so on, nothing can be achieved. But, you know, that's not quite true, because it could, of course, be that this secret key is maybe not a fixed value, but it kind of updates itself, and even if you get 100 bits of every chunk there, you will not be able to come up with anything, any kind of attack. So, let's see. So what do we want from, you know, from a leakage resilient scheme? So I told you there are like two aspects that kind of that leakage resilience should have at the same time, that kind of sets it apart from things that have been done before. So one was, we want leakage to be general, right? So f should be any efficiently computable function. We just want to bound the capacity of the channel, not the type of leakage. And the other thing is we want it to be continuous. And by this, I mean the adversary can choose a fresh f with every query. The total amount of leakage is not a priori bounded. It's just kind of, he can run for, is bounded per round, but not a priori, so, you know, he can get any polynomial amount of leakage. So what has been, you know, there has been, people have looked at into provably secure, using provable security in the context of side channels. For maybe one of the best known papers or works in this aspect is Private Circuits. This was Ishai Sahai Wagner, 03. It got the Test of Time Award. No, wait, no, it didn't. That was it. No, that was me. Sorry, that was the wrong conference. You can't raise it. I mentioned it today. Okay, so who has heard of Private Circuits? So they anticipated a very particular side channel attack, namely where the adversary can probe wires on the circuit. So you have a circuit. The circuit implements the cryptographic algorithm. The adversary can choose some of the wires, and he gets whatever values were carried on this wire. So it's not general at all, but it's continuous. And in fact, arguably has the most influence currently on the chess community, because they really like these things, because they have to come up with these masking schemes and so on. And they really like the fact that they can now do things that come with some kind of provable guarantees and not a lesser talk. OK, the bounded retrieval model. So basically, this is like intrusion resilience that I told you before. So you remember, I told you in the bounded retrieval model, we have the secret. The adversary can leak any function of it. So, right, so any function of it, as long as there is some min entropy left in the key. So definitely, the function is very general, but it's not continuous, right? So the key is maybe big a priori, so you can actually leak a lot, but not more than the key length. So it's not continuous. So, and what we will try to do, so what I will show you now, is actually something that, you know, allows general leakage and is continuous. So there is a little caveat here. When I say general leakage, it will make like a little assumption about, not about the function f, but about to what inputs the function f is applied. So this is called the only computation leaks assumption that I will tell you in a minute and why it's justified. And just let me mention that there actually now exist leakage resilient schemes, which kind of, without any caveat, really can leak any bounded information about the entire secrets and public coins and so on, and they're continuous. And this is, for example, by Haralambiev, Lopez Alt, by Evgeny, Fox 2010, and I think even at the same conference there was thing by Katz and Vinod. So this is like much more recent stuff, arguably much less practical than what I will show you, but just to say that these totally general things also exist. Okay, so I will show you this thing here. And the concrete primitive I want to look at is a stream cipher. So what is a stream cipher? A stream cipher is basically a pseudo-random generator. You have some initial secret state, And then this algorithm takes the state, so you have some initial secret state as zero. Then you have some kind of process. It takes the secret state as zero. It outputs the next state. Let's call this S1. And also some sequence of bits X1. And then you can call it again. Okay, you get the idea. And what we want is that this, so the states S0, S1, S2, they are supposed to be secret. They are in the box, and kind of the adversary should never get to see them. And this sequence of bits, or X1, X2, and so on, they should be pseudo-random. So what we want is that for any I, or for any polynomial I, Xi should be computationally indistinguishable from uniform, given, you know, given all the previous blocks of outputs. This, by the way, as Yao showed, one of the first applications of the of a hybrid argument is equivalent to saying that if you see a sequence of these blocks x1 to xi, you can distinguish this entire sequence from a uniform random sequence. And this subscript c here, what do I mean by this? This simply means no adversary running in time tn for any polynomial t. So we have initially some security parameter n. The adversary can run in time polynomial in n, like n squared, something like that. And no matter what the polynomial t is, I want the advantage of that adversary in distinguishing, you know, xi from u to be negligible. So to be smaller than 1 over any polynomial. So I hope you have seen this. I don't want to. If you haven't seen it, I'm sure that Salil will tomorrow. Basically, the C just means computationally indistinguishable. So what you can have. Okay. So this is a stream cipher. How would the stream cipher now look in the context of leakage attacks? So in leakage attacks, what we said is, okay, now the adversary can, you know, he can kind of, okay, there is no input this time. For, you know, in the black box setting, there is no input, you just get output. But in the leakage setting, we allow the adversary to choose, you know, some leakage function f1. And he will get back some leakage. Let's call this lambda 1, which is, you know, f1 applied to all the secret state, which here is just s0. Then he looks at this. He gets x1. He gets the leakage. He thinks for a while. He says, OK, here is my next leakage function f2. And what he gets back is lambda 2, which is some kind of function of the current state s1, and so on. And what do we mean by a leakage resilient stream cipher? It means that we want this security guarantee as before, even if the adversary, so the next block to be output should be uniform, indistinguishable from random, even given, you know, all the previous blocks and all the leakage so far. So why don't I, so this is I minus 1, this is actually important. Why don't I put I there? Because the ith leakage can actually compute, you know, if you have any leakage function, it could just compute the output xi and output, for example, the first, you know, the first lambda bits of xi. So I cannot hope xi to be, I cannot hope that some output is pseudo-random given leakage that actually sees that output, right? So this is arguably the best we can hope for. And yeah, also something. What I could show is that xi has high Hill pseudo-entropy given that leakage too, but, you know, I'm not going into that. Okay. So can we have a stream cipher like that? Yes? Yes, F, and they are adaptively chosen. Yeah, so exactly. So this F2, I'd call F1, F2, F2 is must only be decided upon by the adversary after he has seen. And there are many different variations, because once you do not allow adaptive Fs, the adversary has to choose F1, F2, and so a priori. It's much easier. Then there are schemes that, then there are stream ciphers that are secure in this sense. Whereas in the sense as I show you, so who sees it? So this notion is also not achievable, no matter what you do. No matter what, you know, I don't want to, if you come up with a construction that you claim is secure in this sense, I don't even have to look at it. I know what the attack is going to be. So who sees it? Give you a minute to think about. it's a totally artificial attack, but you know, we want to prove things at the end of the day. So, but there is just no hope to prove anything because there exists a super artificial attack that even if lambda is one, you just allowed one bit. Yeah. This is the pre-computation attack. It's totally artificial because it works as follows. So let's let t be the length of the secret state, 1,000 bits or whatever, and then define the ith leakage function as follows. The ith leakage function on input si will simply output the ith bit of st. So the leakage function gets the state. The leakage function computes f forward up to st and leaks the ith bit. So f1, right? So f, so here is st somewhere. So f1 would give you the first bit of st. F2, you know, gets s1 as input, computes st, gives you the second bit, and so on. Once I, after t rounds, I learned the entire st, and once I have the entire state, I can, you know, compute forward whatever I want. So there is. No, very artificial, and you know, if you show this to a practitioner, he will laugh at you. He says, you know, leakage function is like timing or something. The leakage function, but you know, we want to have something that is provably secure and maybe still reasonably elegant. So we don't know if there maybe exists some other subtle things that can go wrong. Okay, so we have to make some additional assumption at this point. Page number 6. And the assumption we will make additionally, which you know, hopefully you will think does not ruin the entire you know, appeal of this argument, it was actually proposed long time before this leakage resilient stuff came out by Silvio Micali and Leo Raisin in a paper called Physically Observable Cryptography, which was kind of an early paper which kind of mostly philosophized actually about the possibility of doing provable security in the context of side-channel leakages. It had like many axioms that it said such leakage should satisfy. And one of the axioms, I think there were seven, right? One of the axioms was the only computation leaks, and it said, okay, it's true that, you know, that you can get side-channel leakage, but you have like one handle that you can use, and if you have side-channel leakage, typically the leakage comes from things being computed on. So let's assume actually you have a device. This device has maybe two memory blocks, A and B. They are kind of maybe somehow even physically separated on the chip. Then you have like this chip here, so this is like a super fast chip. It maybe also has some small memory for itself. And assume that the computation is performed as follows. In the first step, this chip only touches memory A, and you know, output something. Only touches this memory A, but doesn't read or write anything in B. And the only computation leaks assumption says, okay, the leakage will only depend on, you know, whatever is touched here, but will be independent of B. So that's the only computation leaks assumption. So if you can kind of clearly separate memories that are accessed in different steps, for example, in a stream cipher, every invocation of that block that I showed you before would be one step, and if that only touches some part of the memory, the leakage function does not get the entire state as the input, but just that part that was touched upon. So maybe in the second step, that's actually what's going to happen. In the second step, you only use this memory block B, so then this leakage lambda 2 will only depend on that. And maybe then in the second step, you are, you know, you go back. Okay, so now I'm going to show you, because it's 15 minutes, now I'm going to show you actually a stream cipher that is leakage resilient in the only computation, under the only computation leaks assumption. And it will look vaguely familiar to something that you've seen like half an hour ago. Because, let's see, Maybe I have this picture even here. Okay. Let's see how this does as a stream cipher. So this is not going to be a stream cipher because we didn't even use computational assumptions, right? But let's say this S1, R1, S2, R2, and so on are the output of a stream cipher. We are in this only computation leaks model. So this would be the initial key is Q and W. So it's a stream cipher that has gigantic keys, so it's kind of stupid. But right, has these gigantic keys. So in the first step, I would, you know, you would get leakage from this here. In the second step, you would get leakage from this here. In the third step, you would get leakage, and so on. And what I showed you before is that as long as the, you know, the entire leakage is sufficiently shorter than Q and W, the next output to be output will be actually information theoretically, statistically close to uniform. So this already is kind of a leakage resilient stream cipher, except that the initial key has to be longer than the total output of the total output of the stream cipher. But this was like the but once you make this observation and you've heard Leo's lecture that you can even kind of increase the amount of pseudo entropy even in the context of leakage or even if secrets are not uniformly random. This gives you the idea to say, okay, so let's kind of try to refresh these keys on the left and right side so that we can kind of, can start outputting pseudo-randomness forever, basically without, without using it up. Maybe I spoiled already too much because now it's not going to. Okay, so here is the construction, so in the last 10 minutes. So the secret key of our stream cipher will be like, we'll have three parts. In fact, the part K0 here, it's part of the key, but it's even public. So this you can actually give out. So this is going to be the first, if you think the first output of the stream cipher. And then it has like two other secret keys, A0 and B0. And think of them as, not as before, these are not hundreds of gigabytes. Think of them as 512 bits or something like that. So it's like something that you can reasonably implement. And the construction does the following. Okay. So in the first step, it only touches like the K0, B0 part that will be important. It computes a value K1 and the value X1 by extracting. Oh, sorry, can you read that? So basically, I should actually when I have this. Okay, so in the first step, we take this public random value K0, our secret value B0, and we extract a value K1. And in fact, this K1 is going to be the next output, right? Okay. Now, what do we do with B0? It looks like alternating extraction, but except now we're not going to just keep B0 as it was. We're going to refresh it. And we refresh it by defining B1 to be PRG of X1. So everybody knows what the pseudo-random generator is. I think you mentioned yesterday. A pseudo-random generator is a cryptographic object that takes a short random string, 512 bits, and expands it to something, a long string that is pseudo-random. What happens on the left side is nothing. So let me just write this. So nothing is touched or changed or anything, A0 stays A0. Now, what do we do in the second step? We do the same, but we kind of alternate. We go back and right. So here, we compute K2, X2, to be extraction of A0, K1. So we out. Output K2 and A2 is going to be A2 is PRG of X2 and here So now, why on earth should this be a leakage resilient stream cipher? So let's remind what the attacker can do in the OCL model. In the only computation leaks model, in the first step, okay, so this is the first step only touches K0 and B0, right? And this is the final output. This is the input, this is the output. So let's see. So the adversary gets some leakage lambda 1, which is a function of these two values. In the second step, he gets leakage here, and so on. Now, yes. Now, I'm not going to do the proof why this is good, but kind of let's try now combine all the things that we have seen in the last 2 days to kind of argue why this should be a good leakage resilient stream cipher. So with the alternating extraction argument, we kind of have seen that this k values, and so k1 should be somewhat, k1 is independent, so k1 would be independent of a1 given all the history, if we wouldn't do this weird stuff with the PRG stuff here, right? But, okay, so, but it still will be a crucial argument in the proof that every time that we can, so we will change this evaluation of the stream cipher step by step, replacing pseudo-random value by uniformly random value, arguing that the two games are computationally distinguishable. It will be the case in these new games that this KIs and BIs and KIs or I, and AIs for odd I will be independent given the view so far. So it will be, no, so this extractor will kind of really output something uniformly random. And then we will show that this refreshing really is meaningful. So what do we know about x1? So x1, if these are independent, so assume that, you know, think of this ki and bi, we're somewhere far down. Assume that they are independent. B0 has sufficiently high min entropy given, you know, the past view of the adversary so far. Then whatever we extract here is going to be uniformly random. Now the adversary gets leakage lambda 1. So x1 is no longer uniformly random given lambda 1, but it has high min entropy. Now, you've seen yesterday that if you apply a PRG to a seed with high min entropy, what you get is a seed that is indistinguishable from something that has high Hill entropy. So it means even though this thing here is, okay, right? So what we know is that this, even given the entire view so far, this B1 here, let's take another, this B1 here is computationally distinguishable, let's say, from some epsilon, from some, let's call it B1 prime, where B1 prime has high, you know, conditional average case min entropy conditioned on whatever we have seen so far. So what we will do in the experiment, so what is actually done in the proof is then you basically carefully do these replacements. You kind of say, okay, I start, you know, initially they are uniformly random. You get leakage. This x1 is uniformly random, but conditioned on lambda 1, it only has high min entropy. Then the output of this PRG will have high Hill pseudo entropy. So it will be, this B1 will be indistinguishable from something that has actually high min entropy. And now I switch the games. Now I replace B1 with B1 tilde, and I claim that these two games are computationally distinguishable. So I have something with high min entropy here, and then I can just basically use the alternating extraction game all, you know, all the way down. This, you know, this looks ugly. It is. It's a highly non-uniform argument, actually, right? So often if you have cryptographic proofs, it tells, you know, you replace this with this. So if a hybrid argument, you plug something in there, and then if the original adversary had advantage epsilon here, it will have some epsilon prime advantage over here. That's not the case here, because the only thing that the dense model theorem gives us is it says such a distribution exists. We don't know what it is, so it doesn't actually give you like a constructive reduction, but it still gives you a meaningful reduction if you assume that this pseudorandom generator is secure in a non-uniform setting, which means that the output of the PRG on the uniform, that no matter what extra auxiliary input you get. So we get some super highly sophisticated information that some aliens computed for, let's say, IAS, in the, you know, right? But even then, IAS is going to be secure with uniform random keys. That's all that you need. So we need that there is no kind of hidden but potentially extremely hard to compute auxiliary information. That's why this proof is non-uniform, but, you know, we're not going into that. Okay, so in the last 2 minutes, Actually, it's good that you finished. So, okay, now maybe let's stop here. So, I will show you one other construction of a leakage resilient stream cipher, which will use a totally different fact, namely what Yevgeny told you, that weak PRFs are secure even if the keys are not uniform. It's going to be a much simpler construction than this. So this will be just like the next 20 minutes of the next block. And then we will actually switch to Hilbert pseudoentropy and see like why the chain rules do not work as we would like them to. OK, so see you in half an hour, I guess.